Welcome to the Four Listeners Program. Welcome aboard, everybody. Thanks for checking us out this week. What up, everybody? I'm Spear, and on the mics with me this week is the Z-Man. What is up, Z?
Yub nub. E-chop nub dub. I told me to pa. Ginjotolia. Nub yub. Glowa.
Oh, my God.
Koti chiti glowa. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, okay.
I tried.
That's a good yep, job. Yep. On the other mic is the mighty Ganthor. What is up, buddy?
Sound like Nell over there, buddy. Are you all right?
Nell?
Nell, the movie with Jodie Foster, Nell. Remember, did they find Jodie Foster out in the woods speaking her own language? You don't remember that movie?
No.
Yeah, there's an obscure reference for everybody out there listening. Ganthor, once again, tapping into that vein of pop culture. Just tapping right into it. Good job, Ganthor.
It's not all I've been tapping.
Yeah. There you go. All right. This week, something must be done about Star Wars Episode 8, The Last Jedi.
There's going to be spoilers.
Spoiler
warning.
Spoiler warning.
If you haven't seen it and you want to see it, well, first of all, you should see it because it's been out for a month.
That's right. So if you haven't seen it, stop the podcast right now. If you're still here, I saw the movie. This was, about 4 or 5 weeks ago now. I saw the movie.
I assume you saw it on opening day, Thursday night.
I did, yeah. It was Thursday night at 8 o'clock. And,
with or without child?
With child. And,
with child.
With child. So I'm with my 10-year-old son and a group of other people. And I saw the movie, and it took me a good 15 minutes before I could say anything. I stood there against the wall, completely silent, while everyone else is kind of just, you know, talking about the movie. And it took me a good 15 minutes to say anything at all. And the first words out of my mouth were, "I didn't like it." And I didn't understand the words that were coming out of my mouth. Like, I had a hard time resolving what my brain was saying. Like, here's two things that don't usually live in the same body. My Star Wars fanaticism, and the fact that I didn't like a Star Wars movie for the first time in my entire life.
And just to recap, Force Awakens?
I love the Force Awakens.
Rogue One?
I liked Rogue One. Didn't love it. Liked it.
Okay.
Didn't love it. But the idea that I wouldn't like a Star Wars movie was so entirely foreign to me that I'm programmed, I'm predisposed to like these movies. The idea that I didn't like it was ridiculous. And I'm not the only one. This is a movie that was incredibly polarizing amongst the Star Wars fan base. Like, if you looked at Rotten Tomatoes when the movie came out, it was, you know, 93% fresh with the critics' ratings.
Mm-hmm.
But then if you looked at the users say, it was like 93% fresh critics, 53% fresh from the users. So it was without exaggeration, it was split right down the middle. Between people who liked it and people who didn't.
What was your response there, Ganthor?
I was going to say I liked it.
I was going with, it's fine. That was the only thing I could say about this movie, was it was fine.
There are some things I could have done without. Love triangles and casinos. Space wizardry, I could have done without that.
Space Mary Poppins?
Yeah.
Space Mary Poppins was an awesome way to...
It was so bad.
That was super weird. That whole scene was super weird. It's like, oh, okay. Yeah. She floats out into outer space, and this is a great time to just let her die. Nope.
Just kidding.
Nope.
Space Mary Poppins.
Zoom, zoom.
Yeah. Space Mary Poppins I had a big problem with. Force time I had a big problem with.
Wait, what's force time?
Force time. It's like FaceTime, but only using the force, right? It's Rey and Kylo Ren talking to each other, you know, via the force.
You don't have an issue with force dream time.
No, I had a big problem with that, too.
Where ghosts come back and tell you things.
So
that whole Yoda scene was like,
Luke,
shit.
Use the force.
Well, all right, so...
Luke, you switched off your targeting computer. What's wrong?
Those kind of, so, all right, fine. As long as we're going to talk about this. There were several things that Rian Johnson did.
I'm just trying to trigger you.
No, that's fine. There were several things that Rian Johnson did with regards to how the force is represented in the movie that I thought were ridiculous.
Hold on. You thought them better or worse than midichlorians?
Worse.
Oh.
Worse than midichlorians. At least midichlorians was a way of trying to explain the whole Chosen One thing.
Dude.
It wasn't the greatest thing in the world, but for me, the Force was always something more intimate. And it just turned, it seemed like in The Last Jedi, Rian Johnson established the Force as a superpower. And you could do anything with the Force. You could project yourself across the universe. You could save yourself from being blasted out into space.
Well, you can Force choke people across the universe.
Yeah, but if you're looking at them, you know what I mean? Like, there were several things that went above and beyond any established known way of using the Force. And it just, for me, it strained credulity. Like, I had a hard time getting my arms around it.
But isn't the Force the thing that connects and binds everything in the universe?
Sure. Yes. It binds us. It penetrates us. It binds the galaxy together.
If we're bound and connected and we're also Force users, why wouldn't we be able to use that to communicate?
Fine. But there were several points in the movie where... Well, hear me out. There were several points in the movie where...
I'm sorry. Your reaction was hilarious.
No, I'm going to poke some... I'm going to poke some holes in that. There were several points in the movie where even Kylo Ren turns around and says to Rey, how are you doing this? Because there's no way you could be doing this. You're not strong enough. The Force would rip you apart. And it turns out it was Snoke that was connecting the whole thing until they killed Snoke, and then they were still able to do it. So now you're wondering, well, who's doing this? Is it Rey? Is it Kylo Ren? Is it Luke somehow doing it? Or is it Rey is so powerful with the Force with absolutely no training that she's able to facilitate this connection? Rey, by the way, with absolutely no Force training, is now able to move an avalanche. We watched Luke Skywalker under the direction of Yoda trying to move a couple of rocks and falls all over himself. This one, with no training whatsoever, is able to move a fucking avalanche.
Well, she's really strong.
But no, but it was never established. And it turns out that...
Well, Luke said he's never seen such raw power before, and it scares him.
He said, I've seen raw power like this once before. It didn't scare me before. It does now.
It does now, yeah.
So he had seen it before. And by the way, as long as we're going to talk about Luke and what he saw... The whole character, so look, my problems with the movie comes down to two things in particular. Number one is the characterization of Luke Skywalker. First and foremost, they completely fucked Luke up. There's no way the Luke Skywalker that was in that movie was the Luke Skywalker that we saw in the original trilogy. Now, someone's going to turn around and say, well, you know, characters progress, they grow, they, you know, become different people as they get older, they experience things. And I'm going to say, sure. If there was anything to tell us how he got from where he was as a hero to where he ended up as a broken man, I would buy it. But there was nothing there. The last time you saw Luke Skywalker, he was a hero. You see him now, and he's a shell of a man who turned his back on his nephew and considered killing him because of the dark side of the Force.
Yeah, but everybody gets tempted, dude. Even Jesus got tempted.
Well, I would say, sure, if that was Luke's first temptation, but it wasn't, because at the end of Return of the Jedi, Luke is tempted again by the dark side of the Force. In fact, he's tempted twice in the cave in Empire and again in the second Death Star in the throne room when he has the opportunity to kill his own father, who's strong with the dark side, and then doesn't. He says, never. I'll never turn to the dark side. He wouldn't kill his own father. He was willing to sacrifice himself, knowing full well that the Emperor was going to kill him. He was willing to sacrifice himself so that he didn't have to kill his own father. And yet here, he's willing to kill his nephew for having dark thoughts in his sleep, undefended.
Yeah. He did admit it was a moment of weakness, though.
Yeah. But my point is that man who went through the hero's journey should not have had that thought in his head to begin with. That, to me, was a false characterization for a hero that many of us grew up with 30 years ago, 40 years ago. And you can't just disrespect and discard that kind of understanding. Not unless you were going to do things along the way to see Luke breaking down from the hero that he had become. Otherwise, it comes out of left field. And what are you supposed to do with that?
I think a lot of it, too, though, is that universe has to move on from Luke. It's been, what, 30 years since he's been in the film?
Sure.
What else are they supposed to do?
Sure.
Luke with another actor? No way.
No. And if the plan was always to kill off Luke, and it seems that that was the plan. It seems that the plan was to kill off Han in Episode 7, kill off Luke in Episode 8.
Because they're all old. They don't want to do that shit anymore.
Right. So they were going to kill off Han, kill off Luke, and then kill off Leia. Like Episode 9 was supposed to be Carrie Fisher's movie. Because, I mean, The Force Awakens was clearly Han's movie. And then The Last Jedi was clearly Luke's. The last movie in the trilogy was going to be Leia's, and I'm sure that she would have had some exit there too, which is, unfortunately not going to happen now with the death of Carrie Fisher. But if the plan was always to take these characters out and for the story to move on from these characters, then for me, you should have stayed with what made the characters who they were and what was established for them when you included them in these movies.
Okay, so why did your Force Awakens hero have Luke run away and hide?
Well, so that was the one thing they did establish was now Luke went off to Octo to die. He's like, I came here to die.
He ran away to not be found because he didn't leave a record for anybody.
Right. He ran away to die because he felt responsible for creating Kylo Ren.
Well, that wasn't Rian Johnson in Force Awakens or Last Jedi. That was J.J. Abrams in Last Jedi.
Well, all J.J. Abrams did was put Luke on Octo.
Force Awakens, I messed up again.
Right. But all J.J. Abrams did was put Luke on Octo as kind of the MacGuffin for The Force Awakens. He didn't say why he was there. The reason for why he was there was established in The Last Jedi when Rian Johnson writes, when Luke says to Rey, I came here to die. And the whole story about Ben and the betrayal from there. That was Rian Johnson, entirely Rian Johnson.
Well, that was. But like I said, well, what would J.J. Abrams' reasoning have been?
You know what? I don't know.
What would you have accepted?
Well, anything other than what Rian Johnson gave me. But what's interesting about that particular statement is it doesn't appear that Rian Johnson and J.J. Abrams really collaborated on the story. Because there were any number of things that were established in The Force Awakens that were either not followed up on or discarded or given a very abrupt answer to.
Like
who is Snoke, right? Snoke in The Force Awakens was this shadowy figure with this big 30-foot hologram, right? And for 2 years, it was all over Star Wars fandom to try to figure out, well, who is Snoke? Who is he? He's one of the Emperor's servants. He's from way beyond the outer reaches. He's Mace Windu come back from the dead. I mean, there were any number of ridiculous theories about who was Snoke. And it was a fan favorite thing to speculate about because we all thought that somewhere in this movie or in the next, somewhere in this trilogy, that storyline, that question was going to pay off.
Right. I agree with you there. It was very disappointing how he was handled.
Yeah.
But I also think it was very disappointing how Kylo Ren was handled as well.
In what way?
I'm not afraid of him.
Well,
I was afraid of him in the beginning when he froze the blaster beam.
Right.
That's cool. Right.
And his freaky ass voice. But then once you saw he's just emo, angry kid, it's like, I'm not.
Why did he have to have that scene with his sister? Or, well, it's not sister. With
Rey.
With Rey, with his shirt off.
Yeah. I didn't need that.
That was for the ladies.
Yeah, if you want to see that, go watch Girls.
It just have to be for the ladies, but.
Well, there you go. It's for people who wanted to see him with his shirt off, whoever they may be.
Like, I like him as an actor, and I didn't understand that. That was just unnecessary.
I thought he was good in it. You know, I thought Adam Driver was good in it. I thought, he was much more angsty and very angry in this movie. And how he cut down Rey was brilliant. That you could see the venom and the vitriol that he's just like, I don't respect you. And that was the other thing. Like that whole scene where he's basically just laying into her. He's saying, you're not special. I'm special. You're not special. I can help you. That was another thing that didn't pay off. Because the other big question coming out of Force Awakens was, who's Rey's parents? Where did Rey come from? Right?
And they say that she doesn't have any, her parents aren't special, but that could be just him fucking with her.
Well, okay, but here's the thing. They spent a lot of time in The Last Jedi establishing that Rey came from humble beginnings. The tag at the end, the code at the end with the kid with the broom, right? When all the, like the, you know, the I don't know, the slaves, I don't even know if they were slaves. Were they slaves on Canto Bight on the casino planet?
Yeah.
Right?
Don't you remember Rose talking about how they're slave kids?
Right, yeah. So here's another example of a nobody who can be strong with the Force, wearing his resistance ring, pulling that broom to him with the Force and then staring out into the stars. I mean, that's just only hammering home the point that anybody can be strong with the Force and build up on this hope in order to take down the dark side of the Force. If they reverse course from that, now in the third movie, and Rey isn't, you know, the child of nobody's drunks who were just on Jakku, junk traders, then to me that's even more disingenuous.
Why?
You can't turn around and make such a big point out of the fact that the Force can be in anybody, and anybody can be special, and anybody can join a resistance and lead to the light, and then come back in the third movie and say, no, we were just kidding. She's really Luke's kid.
Well, you know she's not Luke's kid.
Well, whoever kid? You know, she's Obi-Wan's granddaughter. She's Leia's kid, and they separated Ben and Rey at birth. You
know, where have I heard that before?
Well, right. So, I mean, whatever, and there were any number of these theories. It was, you know, Ben and Rey are actually brother and sister, and they were separated at birth, or you know, she's Luke's kid, and you know, the grave that he was standing over at the end of, you know, at the end of Force Awakens is her mom, or she's Obi-Wan's granddaughter from the Mandalorian woman that he might have had an affair with way back when. Like, this was another favorite thing of people to talk about for 2 years, and it was just discarded.
Why can't it be Yoda's kid?
I don't care whose kid it is, but the point is they just dropped that plot line right there. Boom. We all had that cliffhanger at the end of Force Awakens where, you know, she holds out the lightsaber and she's holding
calls
it to
her.
And she holds out the lightsaber to Luke, and Luke like regards her with this sad and kind of angsty face, like, you know, like the he doesn't know quite what to think about this. He's sad, he's angry, he's wistful, he's whatever. And then as soon as he gets the lightsaber in his hands, what does he do?
Tosses it.
Chucks it over his fucking shoulder. Like, oh, I'm glad you've been waiting 2 years for this fucking moment. Whoop! Fuck you.
Yeah, I could see that. But
right, but hold on. But that's what I'm saying. So the lightsaber called out to her. Why would the lightsaber call out to her if it has nothing to do with her?
That's my point.
Because it knows Luke doesn't want it.
Yeah, but then here's the thing about the lightsaber, too. We all theorized over that, and then what did they do? They split the fucking lightsaber in half. It's broken.
Hold on a second.
Repair it. Every Jedi has to build their own.
Right, but that means she's got to build her own lightsaber now, and she's not using Luke's.
Do lightsabers choose their owners? Is it like Harry Potter and a fucking wand?
You have to build it.
Right, every Jedi gets their own kyber crystal, and then they craft their own.
Okay, so again, how does this lightsaber choose her?
Exactly.
Well, J.J. Abrams came up with that.
Right, and now Rian Johnson discarded it. Right, where's the Lucasfilm story group? Where is anybody providing some continuity?
Right, that was Disney's F up.
Right, so I don't just blame Rian Johnson for this. I mean, this is Rian Johnson, it's Lucasfilm, it's Disney. You know, how the fuck did they let that happen?
Yeah, fuck those guys.
So the Luke, you know, the moment with Luke, the Snoke thing, which was completely just trashed. You know, and I understood that, yeah, right? Because the big bad here was never Snoke. Now the big bad's Kylo, right? It's Kylo Ren. That's clearly the big bad. He's, you know, he's in charge of the whole damn thing now.
Yeah.
It's okay. You had to establish him as the big bad, so it's, you know, a galactic showdown between him and Rey. There's no doubt about that now. That's the big climactic showdown at the end of episode 9.
Yeah.
And the slow burn chase where they're like, well, we can't get to light speed. So all they're doing is just lobbing laser fire at them. I'm like, you're in this big fucking cruiser. You mean to tell me you can't just get in front of them and blow them out of the sky? Like, what the fuck was that?
Or you don't have any friends who can help?
Right, yeah. You can't call in the rest of your fleet to take out this one stupid ship. And oh, by the way, you were outsmarted by a stratagem that is just one step more advanced than putting a brick on the fucking gas pedal and then jumping out of the car.
Yeah.
It's actually less advanced when you think about it, because she had to sacrifice herself in order for that to happen, when all she would have had to do was just hit the gas, put it all the way down, you know, put the brick on the gas pedal, get in an escape pod, and get the fuck out of there.
My 2002 Camry has cruise control.
Well, there you go. I mean,
yeah, couldn't a droid have flown that?
Right? You mean to tell me there were no droids left on that fucking ship? she had to do it herself?
Yeah, but I didn't care about her, though, so...
That's besides the point. Like, everyone in that movie had to sacrifice themselves. For what? There was no there was no joy in that movie. There was, I know it's supposed to be the middle movie and it's supposed to be a little darker and more somber than the others, but everyone had to sacrifice themselves. The woman at the beginning, the bomber who had to sacrifice herself so the bombs would go off. Let's just excuse the fact that bombs go down in zero gravity. I don't know how that works necessarily.
Brother's sister. They were launched from a magnetic accelerator.
Oh, okay. Well, fine. There you go. There's your scientific explanation for that.
Because Star Wars was never lacking in that.
Well, there you go. So there's your explanation. So there's the bomber at the beginning. There's Admiral Holdo. There's shit. Even Finn was willing to sacrifice himself at the end until Rose turns around and says, "Nope, you can't sacrifice yourself. I'm going to sacrifice myself for you."
Like, what? How did they not get shot?
In those little
onto the salty land.
Right, yeah.
And like, and then they have to run, what, like 10 miles back to the base?
Right.
And not one of those AT-ATs could hit them? It would have been quicker for them to just gone to the base to try to destroy it. The bad guy, whatever that thing was called, the cannon thing that they were trying to knock down their wall with.
Yeah. Yeah, the battering ram.
Thing, yeah. Why don't they just go straight for that and try to blow it up instead of going back to the base?
There were so many places where you had to suspend disbelief because none of it really made sense that, you know, it's strained credulity. You're like, at one point I'm throwing my arms up because I'm like, what the fuck is this now? Like, I just couldn't. Did you guys like this movie?
Yeah.
That was fine.
What about it did you like? Like, help me out, because maybe there's a way for you to turn me back to the light side here.
More beautiful.
I'll give you that.
Yeah, because didn't they do, like, most of it was all, like, actual explosions and not all CG?
Yeah, they tried to do practical effects where possible.
Really?
Yeah.
I love that. I hate CG just because.
Yeah, wherever they could do it, they actually used, like, real boom booms.
Yeah, it was the same thing like what they did with Force Awakens. They tried to do as many of the effects with practical effects as possible.
Like, I didn't see anything, like, the whole nurses on Luke's island.
Yeah.
Like, everyone had a big issue with them. I mean, that's standard Star Wars, right? That's been in every movie where that's been that real campy kind of shit.
Sure.
The whole thing with, like, what are the little doughy eye things that look like chickens when...
The porgs!
When Chewie was going to eat one.
The porgs!
Porgs. So, that whole thing, I guess they had needed a buddy for Chewie now, and
no, sorry, that's not why they did those. Spear, I think you know, right?
Merchandising.
No, on the island there were all these birds, and it was easier
to turn them
into those things than to erase them out of the footage.
Well, is that what it is?
No, so yeah. they were inspired by the puffins that are all over the Skellig Michael. That is the actual island in Ireland that they filmed it on. So they didn't paint over them. They created new ones. They were inspired by. It wasn't a practical effect. The whole reason for the porgs was for merchandising. That was the only reason. And don't make any other mistake. That's why they're there.
Well, it's Star Wars. It's not like merchandising has never been a consideration.
That is also very true. I mean, what'd you guys think about the comedy? There was a lot of comedy, and more so in this than others.
There was a couple scenes where I actually did laugh. I did laugh when when Rey knocks down the rocks and it knocks over the nurse cart. Thing's cart. Yeah. I thought that was actually funny.
Yeah.
But other than that, I'm like, there's a lot of jokes that are just like, huh?
Well, Finn's chrome dome comment was stupid. I think that must have been for the kids.
Yeah, there was one joke at the end after, you know, Kylo Ren opens fire on Luke's projection, and, you know, General Hux turns around and says, "You think you got him? I think you got
that,
him."
I think that's funny. I think that's fine. But he would never say that in the context because he'd be
right.
dead.
Yeah.
Well, they don't like each other.
Like, I the mean, whole
Hux,
like
Hux was going to kill him while he was knocked out.
It just seemed like
revived in time.
It just seemed like there was a lot of comedy in there for comedy's sake. You know, that some of it was a little out of place. What do you guys think about the prospect of Rian Johnson now doing his own trilogy of movies?
I would go see him.
Yeah, I was gonna say I'm not holding my breath, but sure.
I'm not gonna discount them.
I will. I think he showed such disdain for the established Star Wars continuity that I worry for what this will be like. You know, I've had a problem with the idea of these Star Wars anthology movies now for a while too, you know, where, you know, how far off the reservation are they going to go? And are these things really going to feel like Star Wars movies? That's what I'm worried about with Rian Johnson. Like, he just doesn't seem to want to play within the established boundaries of the Star Wars universe. And that's unfortunate, because there have been plenty of authors and comic book writers and what have you, creative people who have created stories within the Star Wars universe with or without established characters that managed to progress the story forward while still respecting what had come before. And I think that's the one thing that Rian Johnson did not do.
No comment.
I respect your opinion, but I was hoping you would give it a second viewing.
Of what? The Last Jedi? Mm-hmm. So here's the thing. I probably
like it the second time around. And I say that because I hated Napoleon Dynamite the first time I saw it. I hated The Big Lebowski the first time I saw it. And those are just two of movies that are my absolute favorites after a second look at them.
I probably won't.
You're still going to go.
The thing that I really liked was Luke's demonstration of force mastery and badassness, where he projected himself so bad that it killed him.
Yeah, that to me broke my heart.
After having been shut off from the force for so long.
Yeah, that to me absolutely broke me. Like.
Yeah, but that's the way to go. Hero, you know, they say, you know, the Romans die now when you just after you've won, because, you know, that's the best that things ever going to be.
Yeah, but after seeing what they did to the character, and then seeing that to me, that absolutely broke me. I mean, I was already so, you know, kind of broken by this representation of the character I saw, and then to see him do that and then die off. I'm not exaggerating. I threw my arms up in the air, I covered my mouth, and I sat there in stunned silence until the movie was over. Because I was broken after that. I was like, this is ridiculous. Like, I don't even know how else to describe this. Like, I grew up with this character. Like, I idolized this character. And then to see this broken version of him, to see him betray his family when family was the only thing that was important to him, you know, all the way through the end of Jedi, to see him do what he did there, and to have that moment with Leia, which, by the way, that moment with Leia was awesome. But to know that that moment really didn't happen between the two of them, I mean, it did, but it didn't. And maybe she knew it because she felt that he wasn't there. I don't know. Like, that whole thing broke me. I was like, oh, my God, this fucking sucks.
Well, it wasn't fake or anything.
No, I don't know. He wasn't really there, you know? I don't know. Like, that whole thing just fucking broke me. Just broke me. That was it. And after that, I was done. I was like, no, I'm done with this movie. I'm done with Rian Johnson. Fuck you. Fuck your mom, Rian Johnson. I'm done.
I get it.
And the only thing I'm hopeful for is that J.J. Abrams can bring this thing back and kind of get this all to pay off. I don't know what they're going to do with Carrie Fisher now. You know,
press CGI or like they did Rogue One.
No, they said they won't do it. They said they won't do it.
Give them a year.
So Disney and Lucasfilm need to get their shit together. But we'll always have Hoth.
Yep.
And there's that.
Which is, I think, the pinnacle of Star Wars.
We'll always have Bespin. I feel like, you know, Humphrey Bogart and Casablanca. Mm-hmm. We'll always have Bespin. Me and you, Ganthor.
Yep.
We'll always have Bespin. Come here. Give us a kiss.
Okay.
All right. What did we learn? What did we learn about Star Wars Episode 8, The Last Jedi, Z-Man? What'd you learn?
I want to see a porno with Jar Jar Binks' mom.
My God, that is the worst thing I ever heard of. Ganthor, what did you learn? Save us.
I learned a lot of things. One, I learned how to break you. Two, I learned that Disney needs to hire you to overlook and caretake the Star Wars universe.
Goddamn right.
And three, I learned that...
Spit it out, Ganthor.
Don't swallow it.
I can't remember. Shit.
All right.
I only learned two things.
All right, that's great. What did I learn? I learned that I didn't even go into everything that I didn't like about this movie. I left out the whole Yoda thing, which I thought was nonsense, by the way. Yoda only served to show up in that movie just to fuck with Luke, because blowing up the tree had absolutely no bearing on the story, because all the books ended up in a drawer on the Millennium Falcon. So the only reason for Yoda to show up was to basically just smack Luke around. Like, what the fuck?
Yeah, it woke him up out of his force coma.
Which was, you know, the only reason for Yoda to show up was to get Luke into action, which was, by the way, more eloquently done in the Millennium Falcon when R2 sees him and says, shows him the hologram of Leia, and then Luke turns around and says, that was dirty. You know what I mean? That was much more eloquently done. The only reason Yoda showed up was to fuck with Luke. So you know what? Fuck you, Rian Johnson. That's what I learned. So if you say fuck you, Rian Johnson, why don't you go ahead and let us know on the Facebook page, facebook.com/4listeners or 4listeners.com. You can check out the show on Stitcher Radio, on Apple Podcasts, or on Google Play. Just search for 4listeners. It will pop right on up, and you can give us a tweet on the Twitters at 4listeners, and you can check out our Patreon at patreon.com/4listeners. It's everything/4listeners. We thank you for checking us out this week, and we hope that you will check us out again next week. May the Force be with you, everybody.
What other characters in the Star Wars universe would you hit?
Oh, I obviously hit Padme, right?
No, non-human.
Non-human?
Yeah.
I would hit any of the Twi'lek dancers from Jabba's Palace.
Are they the double-head tentacle?
Yeah, yeah.
Women?
Yeah, the dancers, yeah.
Yeah.
They were sexy.
What other female characters were there besides the singer?
I would bang Admiral Holdo. It's Laura Dern.
Yeah, but she's human, dude.
Non-human? I don't know. I mean...
Would you do an Ewok?
I'm not into the furry thing.
Yeah, but they're sentient beings.
Yeah, but I'm not into the furry thing. I think that would be problematic. It'd be get hair everywhere, but...